This week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick.
It's time for This Week in Virology. This is a special episode recorded on, what is today's date, August 7th?
I don't know, I'm all over the place.
You're all over the place. August 7th, 2014. Hey everybody, I'm Vincent Racaniello. And you are listening to TWiV, the podcast all about viruses. I'm in New York in my office, which I call the TWiV studio, and I have a special guest today. He's from the University of Liverpool, Tom Solomon. Welcome, Tom Solomon.
Thank you. Hi.
Welcome.
Don't you normally do some fancy music after you've said This Week in Virology?
Oh, yeah, that gets added later.
Oh, okay, I thought you might sing it for us.
No, my singing voice is terrible. You are the director of the Institute of Infection and Global Health.
In Liverpool,
which
that's right.
A new institute.
Yeah.
And I met you 2 years ago in Edinburgh, and then I saw you again in Dublin.
That's right.
We can't miss you because you're tall and energetic.
Right.
And we had said, well, if you're ever in New York, you should stop by.
Sure.
And here, 2 years later, here you are. So before you go back to the UK tonight, we'll talk a little virology. When I Googled you to develop my show notes, the name came up, the Mad Running Professor. And I remember back in Edinburgh, you were already the Mad Running Professor.
Yeah, Running Mad Professor.
Running Mad Professor.
Mad Running.
I think will be the title of this episode.
Right.
Right?
Okay, I guess so.
So it's Running Mad or
running
Mad?
Running Mad. Running Mad.
Tom Solomon. So why are you the Running Mad Professor?
So, today in some ways has been typical, running around trying to fit in too many things in quite a mad way. But I got the name from when I ran the London Marathon. I used to do a little bit of running, you know, just around the block kind of thing. And then I work for a charity called the Encephalitis Society. Encephalitis is inflammation and swelling
of
the brain.
I just love the way you say it.
Yeah, you say encephalitis. Okay, so I worked in Texas a couple of years.
So
I'll learn how to
accent.
Say encephalitis. But as your more educated listeners will know, if you take it from the Greek, encephalon, which is brain,
right,
then clearly the word is encephalitis. Mm-hmm. And I've been on a campaign to convert the whole of America to speak properly.
So if I started saying encephalitis here, say teaching my my students, don't you think they would look at me oddly? What are you trying to be?
I think they look at
British?
You oddly anyway.
That's right.
So I work for the Encephalitis Society, and they had a place on the London Marathon, and these places are very hard to get hold of. And they had a runner who was going to run for them, and that runner dropped out at the last minute. And so I was actually on my way to Africa. We've got some work in Malawi. And they phoned me on the way to the airport saying, Tom, you know, we know you do a little bit of running and we need someone for the London Marathon. Mm. And I don't actually remember agreeing to do it. But all I know is when I got off the plane in South Africa, I had these emails saying, congratulations, you've signed up for the Virgin London Marathon. So I panicked a little bit. This was only a month before the marathon started.
And you hadn't done any running?
Not just round the block kind of stuff. Not really a big running. Maybe it was more than a month. But anyway, I panicked. I started running there and then in Johannesburg Airport. My wife, who was with me, picked up her iPhone and started filming it. And then I carried on with my training in Malawi on the wards there and back in Liverpool. And basically, whenever I could, I was running. And all the clips got put together and got on YouTube. Mm-hmm. So if you look on YouTube for Running Mad Professor, you'll find my training video. Which has about 21,000 hits.
We'll have to put it in the show notes for this episode.
That would be fun. But then, I got a lot of people sponsoring me.
Right.
And the thing is, they'd seen the training video, so they were expecting me to run the marathon in the white coat, which I had never planned to do at all. Mm-hmm. But then I kind of thought, oh, okay, I better do that. And since I was dressed as a doctor, I actually had a go at the Guinness World Record for the fastest marathon dressed as a doctor, and I won that as well. So I got a Guinness World Record out of the whole thing. And and we raised about, I think it was £21,000, which, what's that in dollars? 32, 40, 50?
Something like that, yeah.
But it was quite a lot of money, and it was quite a lot of fun as well.
What did you do with the money?
The money all went to the society, to the Encephalitis Society, and they use it. They work on awareness about encephalitis,
okay.
supporting research. They support a bit of research and also information and support.
What was your time in the marathon?
4 hours, 19 minutes, 20 seconds.
This is phenomenal for 1 month of training.
Yeah, maybe I can't. I mean, it was a few years ago. Maybe it was 2 months of training, but it wasn't a lot.
Maybe it was a year.
No, it wasn't. Look at the date on the video. No, I think it was 2 months. But the last 2 weeks, you can't train anyway. They say don't run.
You shouldn't, yeah.
Yeah. Are you a bit of a runner?
No, I don't anymore. I ran when I was a postdoc and a PhD student, but I never did marathons.
No, it's a crazy thing to do.
My student, as you heard earlier, has run marathons and ultra marathons too, which is crazy.
That's really hard stuff.
I know people who do triathlons, right, which are like a marathon, a 100-mile bike race, and something
and
else.
And they swim across the English Channel.
I don't know why. It makes me tired to think of it. So you ran it in a white coat with a stethoscope around your neck,
and the doctor's cap and the
on your face. You had the mask.
I was allowed to have it here.
Oh wow! And then a bag, right?
No, I didn't have to use the one with the bag. Good. But I was worried I might lose the stethoscope, so I had a spare stethoscope in my pocket, and. Yeah, it was good fun, actually. And I've carried on running since then.
And it raises awareness for encephalitis. Yeah. Or encephalitis, sorry. Yeah. I'm going to try and say encephalitis.
Say encephalitis. I'll say encephalitis. And then
that would confuse everyone.
Totally confused.
Right.
But we've done, more recently, we did, so we do quite a lot of work on public engagement and science communication. And our most recent thing was for World Encephalitis Day 2014, which was in February. And we wanted to see if we could make the world's biggest brain out of people standing in the shape of a brain. So again, if you look on YouTube and
they
search,
weren't naked, were they?
No.
You know, there's that photographer who gets thousands of naked people.
Yeah, see, if only I'd thought of that, that would have made it much more fun.
It would have been the right color, right?
Maybe next time. No, we had different colors for the different lobes of the brain. And we used it. We had some of our patients came along and they talked a little bit about their disease. And we talked about problems with memory, temporal lobe damage, and then everyone who's in the temporal lobe kind of...
Wonderful.
Down.
Where did you do this?
So this is in Liverpool, we did it. And again, it's all on YouTube if you search for World's Biggest Brain Liverpool.
Excellent. This is fabulous. I think we should do one for a virus, World's Biggest Virus, right?
Yeah, it'd be fantastic.
I bet I could get people here in New York to do that. We could do it in Central Park.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be good.
But you probably had people organizing it for you in the Society for Encephalitis.
Yeah, I mean, we did. But again, we tend to always do everything as a bit of a whim. I mean, you could plan these things for a year, but we just decided one day to do it. And I think we had about 800 people or something. And I'll show you it later. The video's fun.
Yeah,
and also, and then the video got lots of hits. And so it makes people, you know, people need to know about this condition, especially the public, but also actually surprisingly, healthcare workers, doctors, nurses, because it's not always managed brilliantly well.
Well, I want to talk about encephalitis in a bit, but since I saw you, you've gotten involved in social media and Twitter, and that helps you also spread the word.
Yeah, well, you the thing I remember from when I met you in those occasions was about using social media to become a science communicator.
Yeah.
So I do quite a lot of science communication now, and I think the thing is, I mean, I've changed from the position which a lot of people were in, which is you sort of don't get involved, and then you hear stuff on the radio, and you think, oh, well, what's he know there? You know, they're talking rubbish. So I think it's part of our responsibility, actually. You know, we're funded. A lot of what we do is funded by British taxpayers. A lot of what you do is funded by American taxpayers. I think we have an obligation to explain to people what we're doing and also to spend time with them learning about what they think is important to help direct the research.
Yep. So let's talk a little bit about your upbringing and training. Where are you from originally?
Manchester, which is just up the road from Liverpool in the north of England.
I was there at a meeting maybe a year ago.
Right.
It was another SGM meeting.
Yeah, SGM.
I didn't see you at that one. Right?
No. Was that in Manchester or Liverpool?
It was Manchester. This year it was in Liverpool.
Yeah, I was at that
in,
one.
In April. You were in that? I was asked to go, but
it
coincides with my kids' spring break, and I already was in trouble for the previous 2 years.
Tell me about it.
So I couldn't go, but Paul Dupre organized
Paul,
it. You must know Paul, because he was there in the UK for many years. So you're born in Manchester.
Yeah,
so the heart of industrial
north,
right?
It was the gritty north. And now I'm in Liverpool, which is an hour up the road, but it's not, there's not so much of a gritty north anymore. It's really quite...
Liverpool is where the Beatles came from, right?
The Beatles, and we have a football team that occasionally plays quite well. Not as often as they should.
Where did you go to college?
So I studied medicine in Oxford.
So you go right to medicine, or you have
college? So in the UK, you go aged 18. So aged 17, you have to make a decision.
Oh, wow.
Aged 18, you go and start medical school, undergraduate, mm-hmm. and then I did a degree, a physiological science degree, and then into the clinical training, which was also in Oxford.
Why did you decide to be a doctor? What?
Blimey.
You don't know? No idea?
No, I'm just thinking. I don't think I've been asked that question since I was 17. It feels a bit like being back in...
You didn't have any doctors in your family.
I did. I had a great aunt, actually, two great aunts who were doctors. And back then, for women to be a doctor was really rare. They were. They went to the Royal Free Medical School, which was the only place that women could train. So they were quite something. And I knew them in their dotage, in their real old age. But, I always thought it'd be interesting to study.
Okay, that's fair.
Yeah.
So you actually you didn't want to be a scientist early on. You just wanted to be a physician, right?
It's hard to know. I remember when I was, not at the interview, but beforehand, there were sort of days where they'd get medics in, and they had someone come along from Manchester University telling you all about medicine, and I put my hand up at the end. I was just a schoolboy, and I said, well, the course sounds really interesting, but, there's other things I'd like to do, like maybe I'll be an artist, so could you do the medical course and then go on and do something different? And, of course, she should have said, of course you could, but she didn't. She sort of flipped her lid and said that was a terrible thing. But of course that's wrong, because for a start, medicine is a fantastic training for anything in life, because you learn about people. You see people at their best and you see people at their worst. So I always felt, and I even say to medical students now, look, if you're not too sure, do the course, because it's so interesting, and then who knows where it'll go. And basically during my medical training, especially in Oxford, because there's such a strong academic flavor to it, you kind of get drawn into, you see questions, you want to know what the answers are to the questions, and you kind of get drawn into research.
I was just on a phone call this morning with a fellow who is a science journalist, and he went to medical school.
Yeah.
He did an internship and then decided he wanted to write.
Right.
But, he has a view that most journalists don't have.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly, yeah.
Now, here in the U.S., some people would say it's a waste of medical education to do that sort of thing. Here, I don't know what it's like in the UK, but here medical students are subsidized by the government to a certain extent. Yeah. So the government says, well, we invested in you, you should be a doctor. But I think you're right.
We've had some great, so you mentioned the journalists, but there's some really famous people who were doctors and then went on and did other things.
Yeah.
Let me try and remember. Well, first of all, there's a lot of comedians in Britain who started off in medicine. Maybe that's not the best example. I'm thinking of the goodies that we used to see when we were kids. But there are some authors, Somerset Maugham, who wrote a lot of great short stories and novels. So he started off in medicine. I know quite well Lord Owen, because he was the chancellor of our university in Liverpool, he started off in medicine and then went into politics. So, you need people. I think as long as people are contributing to society in some way, it's great if some of those people, in fact, in the UK, I wish we had more politicians, more members of parliament, more members of the House of Lords who had backgrounds in science and in medicine.
Absolutely.
Because they're it's so valuable.
Same here.
Yeah.
Should be.
Yeah.
Scientists, doctors, whatever, because they have a different perspective.
Yeah.
So after medical school, which was how long?
6 years. Yeah.
What did you do next?
6 years. So even as a medical student, I got interested in traveling and seeing the world.
Mm-hmm.
And originally I traveled just as a student, like you do, and then I got as far as India, and then came back to college, and I'd run out of money, and I thought the only way I can go for my next holiday somewhere interesting is if I can get a bit of support to go. And so there's a guy called David Worrell, who's a professor of tropical medicine in Oxford, who helped me get a little bit of funding to go into a small project in Thailand. And then I met another really inspiring guy called Nick White, who's another medic, works mostly on malaria. And I got interested in malaria and cerebral malaria, which is the brain form of the disease. And then I was still a medical student, but as you get to do an elective where you actually, it's not holiday, but as part of your course, you can go anywhere in the world and do anything. So I then went to Mozambique in Africa and did some work on malaria there. And I got lucky that I did a very small project that got published in The Lancet. And it answered some quite interesting questions about low blood sugar in children who are really sick. So then I came back to Oxford, finished my training, and then I got funding from... So I was interested in malaria and parasites in the brain, and I got funding from the Wellcome Trust to go to Vietnam, mm-hmm. where there was a new unit just opening up. And originally, when I first went there, I thought we were going to be looking at malaria, because that's what people thought the problem was with these children coming into hospital with brain infections. Mm-hmm. But it turned out it wasn't malaria at all. It was this disease called Japanese encephalitis.
Encephalitis.
Indeed, thank you. And that's really where I where I started, because, you know, there were very few people working on this problem, really important viral brain infection.
What year roughly was this?
This was in, I started there in 94, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
1990, yeah. I first went to Vietnam in 91, so that's when I first got interested in these patients. But it took me a while to finish my clinical training.
Yeah.
I remember, yeah, it's all, you get, if you're a medic, you always have this struggle between wanting to go and pursue the research and also progressing your clinical career.
Mm.
So I remember seeing David Weatherall, who was the head of medicine in Oxford back then, and a really inspiring guy, and saying to him, actually this was after I got back from Mozambique, and he'd offered me his house job, which is like the top job in the place. And going to see him and saying, "Hello, I've just come back from Mozambique. I really want to do more of this work. You know, you offered me this house job. Well, thanks very much, but I'm going to get on the next plane back." Instead of shouting at me, which he should have done, he was very nice and patient. He's actually from Liverpool. And he sort of does this and goes, "Tom, let's just stop and have a little think about this for a minute." And he guided me and said, "You know, you can be much more useful. You need to develop your medical career
mm-hmm.
alongside your science career. You have to do a bit of this, a bit of that. And if you develop one too much, so if you get all the way through your clinical training to a consultant, what you would call an attending, I think,
mm-hmm.
the senior person, and you've not done any science, then you're too late to really get into science. Mm. But similarly, if you take all your science forward and don't progress your clinical training, then again, you really close some doors. So you have to do the two in parallel.
Interesting. So how long did you spend in Vietnam?
I was there nearly 4 years.
And then... time. That was after you'd finished your medical
training.
Finished
my basic medical training, yeah. And then I came back to the UK, and mm-hmm. in Vietnam we did some work on Japanese encephalitis.
Mm-hmm.
And again, kind of got lucky in a way, just showing some quite interesting things that hadn't been described before. So you and I were talking about polio earlier and polio eradication. So this was right in the middle of the polio eradication campaign.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Polio had more or less been cleared from Vietnam, but we kept seeing children with what looked like polio, flaccid paralysis.
Mm-hmm.
But when you did the diagnostics, it wasn't polio. So we actually started doing diagnostics for other things, and we showed that Japanese encephalitis virus can cause a polio-like illness,
mm-hmm.
Which hadn't been described at all back then, and was published in The Lancet again. And so, again, it was just from... basically simple clinical observations and not accepting the dogma, doing your own studies.
So after that, you went back to the UK?
Back to the UK, more clinical training, and applied for more funding from the Wellcome Trust,
mm-hmm.
who I then wanted to do some more virology and learn a bit more about the viruses. So I came with a Wellcome Fellowship to University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston,
mm-hmm.
where I learned to say encephalitis. And one or two other things.
It's an interesting culture, isn't it?
Well, the thing is about Texas, they talk real slow.
Yeah.
Things happen real slow. I have to be careful. I've just alienated half the Texan population. Apologies. But it's very different, but it's very interesting. It's a great place to work.
Well, Galveston has a BSL-4,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so it was, and it was the place. So I worked with Alan Barrett, who's mm-hmm. a virologist, as you know. Bob Shope.
Yep.
Bob Tesh. C.J. Peters just joined, so it was a really great time to be there. Really interesting.
What did you work on?
Japanese encephalitis virus.
Like what aspects?
Well, what I was really interested in, you know, we know all these kids get infected with the virus in Asia. Most of them get away with it. A small number get sick. And I wanted to see, are there virulence determinants? Is it because of the virus? Is that why some people get
mm-hmm.
sick, that they're
mm-hmm.
getting a particular strain of the virus? So that was the intention. That's what I said on the proposal to the Wellcome Trust.
Right.
What I ended up looking at was different, because the start point was that you have different genotypes. There's 4 or 5 genotypes of virus.
Mm-hmm.
And back then it seemed to be that genotypes 1 and 3 were what you found where you had the big epidemics in places like northern Thailand, northern Vietnam, etc. So big epidemics seemed to be associated with 2 genotypes. Where you get year-round disease in Malaysia, Indonesia,
mm-hmm.
it seemed that it was 2 different genotypes. So I basically sequenced everything I could get my hands on, put it all on a phylogenetic tree, couldn't make any sense of it at all. It certainly didn't seem to follow that pattern. Mm. And then I had, literally in the shower in Galveston, I can still remember it, one of those eureka moments, which are very rare, aren't they? But when you suddenly, it suddenly makes sense. And basically, the only way to explain the distribution was that the virus must have originated in the Indonesia-Malaysia region. In fact, in that part of the world, you get all four genotypes. And then the more recently evolved genotypes, 1, 2, and 3, have spread to new areas. And it's when they arrive in new areas, Japan, northern Thailand, that they cause the big outbreaks.
Right.
So we kind of think that that's the best.
That's because there's big seronegative population?
Yeah, and also it's to do, the size of the outbreaks, I think, is more to do with actually climate, weather patterns, temperature patterns than anything else.
Because it's a mosquito-borne
infection, right? Yeah. So in Indonesia and Malaysia, we work in Malaysia, you've got year-round, the temperature's pretty stable, so you've got year-round mosquito transmission, so you've got year-round virus transmission. So you've got a low level of activity, low level of disease, steady amount of patients, maybe a bit of a bump in the summer months after the start of the rains. In northern Vietnam or in China, it's cool for most of the year, and then you have the summer. So for most of the year, there's not the mosquito activity, and then you get the summer. And maybe the one summer, maybe there's not that much activity, and then the next year, maybe that much. But then there's a big amount of activity, and suddenly you've got a whole population of kids under 3 years old who've never met the virus, and they're all exposed to, you know, they get large inoculums, and so I think that is, so basically, I, you know, my start point was, is it the virus or is it the host? And it turns out it's the weather.
Right. Yeah. So the is there a reservoir?
Yeah, so the reservoir for Japanese encephalitis virus is pigs. And birds, mainly birds, wading birds like egrets.
And they're fine with the virus, these animals?
Yeah, they don't get sick. Pigs have miscarriages, but they don't get sick. And the mosquitoes, it's a Culex mosquito, which breeds in the dirty rice paddy fields, likes the muddy water. And, you know, in nature, it's just happily transmitting this virus among the birds, among the pigs. But it's just occasionally, from the virus point of view, humans get bitten and the virus gets into the humans. It doesn't gain anything from being in us. We're dead end hosts. Yeah, we don't pass it on.
But just like West Nile.
Yeah, in fact, so it was interesting. I was here in the States when West Nile really happened. So it was interesting seeing that from all sorts of viewpoints.
Yeah. So where else is Japanese
encephalitis? So it's all over Asia. India, it's big. Thailand, Malaysia, all the Southeast Asian countries. It's got as far as India. It hasn't got much further west at the moment, and there's, you know, interesting speculations about why that might be. And then going south, it occasionally has incursions into Australia. But they've managed to, when that's happened, they've managed to sort of, it's fizzled out with some good vector control.
You must be interested in the movement of chikungunya, right?
Yeah, chikungunya's been an interesting story,
Because it's here now in the US?
Yeah,
Indigenous cases spread from person to person, Which was predicted. I mean, it was also similarly restricted years and years ago.
Yeah.
Slowly spread, got to a new mosquito and so forth.
Yeah, and there's no doubt that these pathogens can move, and you know, we do, there is certainly a role for keeping an eye on them and trying to predict what's going to happen.
Sure.
In fact, in the UK now, we've the UK government has given us a lot of money to set up what's called an NIHR, National Institute for Health Research, Health Protection Research Unit. It's a terrible mouthful. Anyway, ours is a Health Protection Research Unit in Emerging and Zoonotic Infections. And this is exactly what we're doing, looking at these diseases and trying to predict the spread.
So had you intended to just stay in Texas for a while and go back to the UK?
Well, they offered me, very generously offered me a position to stay in Texas. But the way, what Wellcome Trust do, are they're quite keen on funding people to go to places, then to learn things, and then to bring that expertise back to the UK.
Yeah, right.
So I didn't have to come back, but... Liverpool had also been, by this stage I was in Liverpool, and they were very supportive of me. So I thought, I'll come back to Liverpool and see how it goes. And they've continued to be fantastically supportive and allowed us to grow not only my research group, but also recently we've reorganized the way we do things to form this Institute of Infection and Global Health, where we're doing as a whole institute what my group has done over the years, bringing together the medics, the basic scientists, the entomologists, the vets, the whole crowd to study one problem.
So encephalitis is inflammation of the brain.
Yeah.
Can be caused by a virus, but other things can cause it as well.
Yeah.
What else?
Well, there's been a lot of interest in antibody-mediated encephalitis in recent years.
Very good.
This is when it's the body's immune reaction. So, you know, we make antibodies all the time to fight whatever pathogen we think we're dealing with. But sometimes things go wrong and we make antibodies against NMDA receptors, which are very important receptors in the brain. Have you heard of NMDA receptor encephalitis or not? Yeah.
I haven't heard of encephalitis, but of course I've heard of the receptors.
The receptors, yeah. So this is quite a hot new area.
Yeah.
But quite often we see patients with encephalitis and we don't get the virus, we don't get the bug. And, you know, then the question is maybe it's more about the body's immune reaction.
When you have a patient who presents with encephalitis, what's the first thing you do?
So they'll present with a history, the story of a fever, headaches, confusion, often.
I have that every day.
Yeah, confusion. Well, yeah, and behavioural change. So it's hard. It's hard to diagnose. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the points. So your average GP might see somebody who's a little bit like that.
Yeah.
The warning signs have to be the confusion, the strange behaviour, maybe a bit disorientated.
Yeah.
And then at that stage, families may bring them to hospital or they may take them to the doctors. And we're really pushing a lot of our research is trying to understand what governs when doctors do things. Why do some doctors see a patient like that and they say, this, you know, we need to investigate.
Yeah.
And others don't even let them through the front door. If they have a fit, they get through the front door a lot quicker because everybody knows, you know, seizure is a problem.
Right.
So we get them in, we examine them, and then we investigate. And the key investigation to diagnose any brain infection is a lumbar puncture or spinal tap, as you call it here, where you put a needle in the spine, get the fluid off. And essentially, you're looking at it in two ways. Firstly, you're looking for general changes that tell you something's wrong. So you're looking down the microscope at the cells. And if you see too many cells, that tells you that there's some kind of inflammation. And the type of cells might tell you whether it's a virus or bacteria.
So normally, the CSF contains cells.
So yeah, cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, contains a few cells. Less than 5 per mil is normal.
These are lymphocytes or?
Yeah, normally actually a few polymorph nuclear cells, neutrophils.
So someone with an infection would have more
cells. They might have 20, 40, 100, 200. Those are the sorts of numbers for encephalitis. If it's more like the thousands, that's more like a bacterial meningitis.
So if you saw normal numbers of cells, what would you do?
If we saw normal numbers of cells, sometimes that might just be because they've come to hospital early and their cell reaction hasn't developed. So if we're worried that this could be encephalitis or encephalitis, then, you know, the most common one in our setting that is treatable is herpes simplex virus. So we would start acyclovir treatment for that.
Without any diagnostic tests?
At that stage, we're worried it's herpes encephalitis, especially if there are cells in the spinal fluid. We're going to get a PCR done for herpes virus as soon as possible.
Okay.
But if the clinical picture fits encephalitis, we might by this stage have also done a brain scan, and that might show swelling in the temporal lobes, which is where we know the problem is. So we start the treatment.
Mm.
And again, we've recently written national guidelines to try and get everyone just to follow these simple steps.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then we'll get the PCR back. It might be within a day. It might take longer. And then we'll have a think again.
And it's always a herpes PCR initially, or is it a pan-viral PCR?
So we typically would look for herpes simplex virus, types 1 and 2, herpes zostervirus.
Mm-hmm.
We often look for enteroviruses as well in the initial screen. So most hospitals will do those as the starting four. Now, if you're in the States and it's the right time of year, they'll also look for West Nile virus.
Mm-hmm. And if you were elsewhere in the world, what other viruses would you look for?
Well, so if you're in Asia, you'd look for Japanese encephalitis virus. You'd look for Enterovirus 71. We do a lot of work on EV71, which is, as you probably know, has caused massive outbreaks of hand, foot, and mouth disease, with a proportion of people getting encephalitis. In Africa, it's a slightly different story, and it's interesting. So in Africa, everybody who turns up, not everybody, but many children who turn up to hospital with fever and altered sensorium, as we call it, altered mental status, confusion, a good proportion of them have malaria parasites in their blood. That's because every kid, when I was in Mozambique all those years ago, we did a study in a village outside Maputo, and we just bled every kid playing football in a...
Mm-hmm.
And a third of them had malaria parasites.
Yeah.
So that, but the problem is that means when these kids come to hospital, the initial reaction is, oh, they've got malaria parasites, they're in coma, this is cerebral malaria, which, as you may know, is a, it's a syndrome of the malaria parasites causing the blood to sludge up in the brain and to cause coma through that. They call it sequestration. But we started looking at these children for other things. So, for example, I've got a welcome fellow, as he was then, Matt Malewa, who is a Malawian, and this is where we started our work in Malawi, who showed that actually a good proportion of these children who died of so-called cerebral malaria actually had rabies virus in their brain, shown at autopsy, and it just hadn't been diagnosed.
You wouldn't necessarily check for rabies in the UK, would you?
No, not unless there's a travel history.
Yeah. So that's another thing. If there's a travel history, that would modify what you're looking for.
Yeah, that affects what you do. So in Africa, we found rabies is underreported and is important. And then another welcome fellow, Laura Benjamin, has done some really neat work, actually not looking in malaria, but looking at patients who have stroke. And many of these have HIV. There's a whole story, as you probably know, around HIV being a cause of stroke in young people. Mm-hmm. And this is work that she's done. She's looking at that, and she's shown how important HIV is in these people. And also started to look at the mechanisms.
Before I forget, speaking of fellows, one of your fellows, or maybe a past fellow, is a listener of TWiV, Lance.
Yeah, Lance Turtle. Hi, Lance. Thanks for getting me here. It's taken 2 years. Lance is a great follower of TWiV. So I try and follow a bit, but unfortunately I struggle to have the luxury to listen for an hour at a time. But I mean, it's good for when you're running. You know, it takes your mind off the pain.
But you stop running though, right?
I don't run for an hour anymore. That's my problem. I only run for 45 minutes. But Lance keeps us all posted with
He's
with
still
updates.
With you.
Yeah, he is. And he was working on Japanese encephalitis in India. Again, really challenging settings. You know, some of these guys really go to tough places to work. Yeah. And he's done really well looking at T-cell responses in patients with JE and trying to understand what the T cells are responding to, and ultimately to try and understand whether they're protective or whether they're actually contributing to the disease mechanisms.
I think he's in Bangalore, is that right?
Yeah, he's been in Bangalore.
Because when he writes, he always tells us the weather in Bangalore.
Yeah, he told me I should tell you the weather. Sorry, Lance, sorry. So the weather in New York, have a look, beautiful. It's beautiful, it's hot.
Let's see what the temperature is. We'll get the weather.
Also, have you ever shown people the view out of your window here?
I don't think
you
so.
You should do that. Maybe cut that in at the end because it's a lovely sunny day out there.
I'll turn around at the end and cut in a piece. Yeah. Isn't it gorgeous out there? We have a great view. Today it's sunny. You know, we've got some puffy clouds there over the Hudson. It's usually, I'm not looking out the window when I record. I sit at my desk over there. So this is unusual. And it's 27 Celsius. Partly cloudy. Nice day.
I'm just trying to get on and get Liverpool because I know it's the tradition. I'll be in trouble for Liverpool. Okay, here we are. We have Liverpool. It's a glorious day. It's 72 degrees. There's not a cloud in the sky. There's a gentle breeze for those that want to do some sailing on the Mersey Estuary. And the shipping forecast is good.
Shipping forecast?
Do you know the shipping forecast?
No, what is that?
Oh, it's brilliant. You'd love it. we have it on BBC radio every morning, twice a day, but in the morning. And they go around the whole of the British Isles telling you each station and what the weather is like.
Wonderful.
But they don't use the English language like we've just done with in between words. They just give you the facts. So it'll say things like Dogger Bank, 72, fair, close to middling, improving or something. I don't know the words exactly. Yeah. But it's like a chant and then they go around.
Wow, that's nice. I like that. So Liverpool is where you're headed tonight, right?
Yeah, I'm getting on the plane
back
tonight.
Can you fly? You fly direct to Liverpool from here?
Fly to Manchester, and in fact, I was hoping to go direct to the lab, but I'm going diverting slightly to the BBC studios to talk about the Ebola outbreak.
That's
which,
right.
As you know, there's been a lot of interest in.
It's ongoing as we speak. I don't know when we're releasing this, but it's been ongoing since March, right, of this year?
Yeah, February. I think the first cases were. Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about that. That's a virus that gets in the brain.
Yeah,
right?
It does, although that's not the main problem with Ebola.
Right. So why do you think the outbreak has spread so extensively in Africa?
Yeah, this has. So as you know, this has been the biggest outbreak with now more than 900 deaths and approximately 1,800 cases. And there were some initial concerns that maybe there's something different about this virus, but we know now that's not the case.
It's not. It's been sequenced, yeah.
But the problem is it's all about how people respond when there is an outbreak. So this is the first outbreak in West Africa.
Right.
And essentially what we're seeing is the same kind of panicky, fearful, anxious response as we saw in Central Africa when outbreaks first happened 35 years ago. So basically when people are getting sick, instead of going to see the medical authorities and getting help and getting the treatment that might save them and being put in isolation so that they don't spread the disease to others, they're doing the opposite. They're running scared. It means that their families end up looking after them, so their families then get sick because, as you know, the virus is spread through bodily secretions. And, you know, unfortunately, this is what's characterized the whole outbreak. And I think there have been a couple of key moments as well. So, it's bad enough to have all that happening. But I think the things that certainly really triggered a response in the UK and when the government asked us to start looking at it was two things that happened. Firstly, the doctor, one of the local doctors who was supposedly leading the campaign in Sierra Leone, sadly got ill and died from Ebola. And, you know, that triggers the response and the thoughts, well, you know, if he can't protect himself, then what hope is there for everyone else? And then the other thing was for the first time it's been transported or transmitted via a passenger on an airline plane, someone who picked up the disease. He was an American Liberian, got sick in Liberia, got infected in Liberia, didn't realise he was sick, got on a plane, came to Nigeria, and as he got off the plane realised he was sick, and he sadly died as well.
Has he transmitted it to anyone in Nigeria?
There's been some secondary cases in Nigeria as well now. I think a doctor and a nurse, I think it's four or five. So this is worrying. I don't think there's any doubt about it being worrying. And as you probably know, the World Health Organization are meeting today. They've got a sort of an emergency response meeting to decide on what the international response should be.
So when you travel and you don't know you've been infected, then that's an easy way to infect other people at the other end, obviously, right?
Yeah, I mean, easy and not easy. So there's a big, there's quite a lot of confusion in the media about how infectious this is. You know, it's not a respiratory pathogen. It's not like the guy on the plane is going to be coughing over other people and passing it like that. So no one on the plane got sick. But the people who get sick are the medical staff who try and look after you when you're bleeding, vomiting, diarrhea. But again, the important thing is we know how to make sure that doesn't happen. We know that if the medical staff are properly wearing the full protective equipment and have been trained in how to use it, how to wear it, how to decontaminate, then they won't get sick.
Yeah.
But again, unfortunately, you know, when this guy got off the plane, as I understand it, the first responders, if you like, they obviously don't have that equipment available. Mm. They did their best. But it's very sad for those people.
Now, in Guinea, in Sierra Leone and Liberia. In the hospitals there, are they gowning up completely?
Well, this is one of the problems. So there have been at least 60 deaths now among healthcare workers. Mm. And all those healthcare workers have been people who unfortunately didn't have access to the full equipment. So they're wearing gloves, they're wearing masks, maybe aprons.
Yeah.
And you would hope, you'd like to think that would protect you, and it should protect you, because this virus doesn't bore its way through the skin, you know, but it gets in through cuts, it gets in through mucous membranes. Mm-hmm. And the problem is, all of us all the time, even if you're wearing gloves, you know, if you're not careful, you touch your nose, you scratch your eye.
Right.
And if you've got Ebola on your fingers, that's how you're going to get infected. Yeah. At least that's our current understanding.
Yeah. You were telling me before, even if you have a gown, you have to know how to take it off.
Yeah, you have to know how to take it off, because if you think about it, if you take this thing off in the wrong way, you're not careful, you'll be touching the outside of it with your, you know, if you take your gloves off first, for example, and then you take everything else off. So you need training, and people buddy up and help each other get the gowns on and off, make sure they decontaminate.
Now, as you know, a couple of Americans were infected and flown back to the U.S. For treatment.
Yeah.
Is that a good idea? A lot of people here are going nuts over it.
Yeah, I know. Well, I've been following the news media, and in fact, I've done a few interviews with people like Associated Press and some of the other agencies. Well, I think there's several issues there. The first issue is about the treatment they were given. They've been given this drug called ZMAP, which is a humanized monoclonal antibody. It's a cocktail of three antibodies. Right. It works in, or at least it appears to work in the monkey model. It's been given to, I think, eight primates. It was given relatively soon after the virus was given, so I think within 24 hours, within 48 hours, certainly before the monkeys got sick. but it seemed to be effective.
Yeah.
And then on the basis of that, it was given on a compassionate basis to two Americans who got sick in Liberia. And they've both done relatively well. They then were brought to the United States, and they appear to be doing well. So, but whether that's the treatment,
yeah,
or whether that's the natural
N equals two, you know,
knows,
it's too small.
But I don't know. I mean, is there anything wrong with bringing back your expatriates who are sick? We do it for other conditions. One of your, was it Trump, I think, Donald Trump, said that they should be left to sort of rot in Africa. Yeah. What was his expression? Maybe you don't want to go into this on TWiV. I don't know.
I don't know what he said.
But basically, I don't think it was a very helpful comment. Yeah. And you can be sure that if someone like him was sick in Africa, they'd
sure
want to come home.
Well, in your country, you would bring citizens back,
yeah,
and treat them.
Yeah, of course we would. It's what you do. I mean,
yeah.
So. But I also actually think it's a smart move anyway, because if you are sitting in the United States and you're worried that someone might get off a plane with this, just like they did in Nigeria, well, isn't it better to have had a bit of a heads up about how we manage it? How do we do our procedures? How do we care for people? So I don't think I think it's a sensible thing to do. But there are issues around the use of these drugs.
Sure. I mean, and this is why we need to have BSL-4 labs to study them and vaccines, because you need to have challenge experiments, which you can only do with virus.
Yeah.
You can only do so much with pseudotyped viruses and so forth. You
have
to have Ebola virus in an animal model, and that has to be done in a BSL-4. And as you may know, right now, there are some people in the U.S. who are calling for a shutting down of BSL-4 in three labs.
I have. I find it extraordinary. But, I mean, this country is extraordinary in so many ways. But, So, I was at Harvard before I came here to be with you, and I don't think I'm spilling any secrets here. That, you know, I think it's pretty well known. They have a BSL-4 lab there, but they
in Boston,
in Boston. But they've I think have had some difficulties to be able to do the kind of work that you want to do in those.
It's not
facilities.
Open. It's not opened yet.
Right.
The Needle, the National Emerging Infectious Diseases Laboratory.
And do you know why it's not opened?
Yeah, because the neighborhood has been objecting.
Yeah.
And
so that is well known. So I mean, that's nuts, though, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And so I visited it actually and did a documentary a couple of years ago. It's a wonderful facility.
Yeah.
And we need places like that, and that's where the Ebola and Marburg and Lassa therapies will come from.
Of course.
So I don't understand
why
people don't get it. I guess we don't do a good enough job communicating that.
Well, that's why. I mean, it's true, actually. I think one can blame the public, but really it's our job. Is it any wonder? I mean, you and I have both been doing media work in the last few days, trying to sort of get a sensible, balanced message out there. And there are some really good journalists, really good reporters who really want to do that. But then there are also people who realize it makes a better story to have a dramatic headline and to make it all sound scary. And
then if
that's what people think, then no wonder they're not going to want people working on that pathogen. But I think the other issue around the new treatments is how we move from developing and designing new drugs, which people are doing. I think the American government have invested quite a lot in that in recent years, which is great. But how you move from there to actually knowing which drugs are effective in humans.
It's hard, yes.
And we this drug's been used on a compassionate basis. There are calls now for using these drugs more widely. But I really think we're not quite approaching the whole situation the way we should.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the regulatory hurdles that we make for clinical trials are, they might be fine for some, tablet that somebody's going to take once a day for the rest of their life to deal with their itchy feet.
Right.
You know, but that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about the need to get potential treatments into clinical trials where they're needed very quickly. And so all the steps that we normally go through, for example, the phase one testing, which is to see, you give it to volunteers and you see, is it safe in them?
Right.
Well, let's take ZMAP or let's take any other new drug which is being developed. Do we really care whether it causes headaches and a bit of fever in healthy volunteers? No, we don't.
No, because these people are
dying
likely
from this
to die.
So, we have to cut through some of that.
Well, that's what happened when AIDS emerged, right?
Yeah.
The FDA was going at its usual plodding rate.
Yeah.
And the patient said, we need
drugs. Yeah.
And that became fast tracking.
Yeah.
Which
it
is good.
Fast track. I mean, the sad thing is that the African people living in villages are not really, they don't really have this voice, this advocacy for fast track. Hopefully their governments will push for it. And although we don't want to detract from the important message about, you know, this disease will be controlled by public health measures, by people isolating themselves, not spreading the disease, etc. That's the most important message. But on the other hand, if we are going to develop treatments, we have to take... The only way you're going to see if a drug works is by trying it in a clinical trial during an outbreak.
Do you think that there's a place for a vaccine? You know, the incidence isn't huge, and you could argue that a good antiviral or monoclonal therapy might be enough.
I certainly think vaccines should be developed. Quite how they would be used and who they would be used in is hard to know. But I think we need a sort of a dual approach. We need to develop drugs and we need to develop vaccines. Nobody's ever going to suggest we vaccinate the whole of West Africa.
Of course.
That wouldn't make sense. But, you know, if we had a vaccine now that we could do some kind of ring vaccination or mass vaccination.
Yeah. When there's an outbreak, you can do that. Exactly.
But, of course, the problem is, and this relates to, so you may have seen some criticism in the media that says, you know, it's more on the web, you know, it's the conspiracy theories, it's the angry mob. Oh, why were these secret drugs only reserved for Americans? Why weren't they given to Africans? You know, there's a sort of bit of a hullabaloo.
Yeah.
But that's inappropriate. Basically, the situation is we can't even convince these frightened villagers who've never come across anything like this before to come to hospital to have simple drips, which we know will increase their chance of survival.
Really? An IV drip?
An IV drip.
Just saline?
Yeah, if you get fluid into people and stop them going into shock, they die of shock. They become dehydrated, they become acidotic, their metabolism's deranged, their organs shut down. They don't die from bleeding, usually. And we know that the mortality rate's 90%. But if you treat people, if you get them early and treat them with fluid, you don't save everyone by any means, but the mortality drops to about 60%. So... But if you think about it, if we can't even convince people to do that, then it would be totally inappropriate to be going with an experimental drug and saying, oh, try our drug. And of course, you'll remember the HIV stories where people felt that HIV was being trialed in Africa,
right.
You know, for the West's benefit.
Polio vaccine.
Yeah, and they were being used for guinea pigs. So I don't think I don't think, you know, even if we had a vaccine now, let's say we had a vaccine today, could you really imagine trying to get that into the communities that need it? It would be really difficult.
You know, this is really important to remember. People here and in the UK have a different view of healthcare. They think, yeah, you just go to the hospital and you get treated. But it's not the case, clearly, because people are afraid, as you said. And, and if you do go to hospital, you're not always going to get the appropriate care.
Exactly. Right? So part of the work, part of the research we're doing through our Health Protection Research Unit, starting to do is to understand these behaviors. You know, in fact, it comes back to the same thing we talked about for managing brain infections in the UK or in America. It's all about how people behave, what governs how a doctor behaves when they're faced with a patient, what governs how a villager in Africa behaves when their, you know, husband has got sick. So there is a role for studying these things, because ultimately if you study people's behavior, you can change it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not something I think most people think of
when... Not what your average molecular virologist spends his time
worrying about. That's right. So you have plans to go to any of these Western African countries?
Possibly, we're putting together a team to go out there.
What would you do?
Well, so we have people there at the moment through our unit. We have people on the diagnostic side. Mm-hmm. So there's the diagnostic virology lab. We have people on the public health side working with governments there, advising on outbreak control. But actually, what is also needed is just sensible people on the wards, clinicians, who can help look after patients, put drips in, etc. So, and we have, I don't think, we've got discussion back in Liverpool at the moment. I don't think our most junior doctors, I wouldn't send them, I don't want them going. But sensible people like Lance and others who've worked overseas, who can stay calm in a difficult situation, who can follow the training, and who can, it's not rocket science in terms of the medicine. It's about putting drips up, giving fluid, acid-base balance. It's what we've all done in our past, in our training. I haven't done it for a few years, so there's a bit of a debate about whether people like me would be useful. On the one hand, I mean, I've done, because I still do a little bit of work overseas, I'm probably a bit fresher than many of my consultant colleagues. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I wouldn't go out myself without, again, spending a bit of time on ITU, just getting up to
ITU
speed.
ITU being?
The intensive care unit. But also, I have a sort of policy in my institute is I don't ask people to do things that I'm not prepared to do mm-hmm, myself, be mm-hmm. that stay up all night working on a paper or writing a grant, washing up the coffee cups, or maybe going out.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is, if we're serious about trying to set up some of these studies to look at treatments, and we've worked on these. I've done treatment trials for hemorrhagic fevers before in Asia. I've done trials with new antiviral drugs in mm-hmm. Japanese encephalitis. Then, you know, it'd be helpful to go out there and try and work with the African doctors and the governments to work out what the best approach would be.
Well, good luck if you do go.
Thank you very much.
So let's get back to your work.
Yeah.
I'm curious of how you mentioned before how you mix the clinical and the research parts together. I know you have patients coming in with
You have to run around like a madman, basically.
That's why you're the mad running. Yeah. What is it? The mad running,
mad
professor? Is that it?
I think it's running mad.
Running mad. You are running mad too.
Yeah.
So I know I understand the clinical part.
Yeah.
How does the research fit into that?
So we have in my team we have about 25 people. In the Brain Infections Group in Liverpool, who are either working on UK brain problems. So a couple of the fellows, Ben Michael is doing this, Sylvie Ann DeFres, we've got a whole team, Fiona McGill. So these are, again, really bright young doctors who are looking at some of the clinical problems and doing some of the laboratory work with it. We have a paediatric team as well, headed by my wife, actually, Rachel Neen. She's a paediatric neurologist. Mike Griffiths is a senior lecturer. You realize that I'm worried I'm going to be in trouble for not mentioning people.
Yeah, I can tell.
Do you mind?
You got them all. No, it's fine.
Anyway, so we've got a great clinical team. We've got a lab team as well. Mm-hmm. I definitely won't remember everyone now. I'll put the pressure on myself. But we've Gossia, Neck, Ajani, Patabendiji. So you're more interested in what we're doing than the names. What are we doing? We tend to be looking at patients. We look at the problems in the patients. We work on their samples in terms of the diagnostics, mm-hmm. but also disease mechanisms. We have some very neat models. Ajani Patabendige is running a model of the blood-brain barrier. We tend to not work, we do a bit of mouse work, but we tend to work mostly on human models, human tissue, because mm-hmm. we think our strength is looking at patients, trying to understand what's going on with them, trying to understand what the pathogens are doing, either in them or in models of human tissue. So we have a blood-brain barrier model. So, I mean, the work of my group goes all the way from the left-hand end. We do some basic molecular virology through the clinical research on the patients and then through the epidemiology, the population health, the programmatic. So mm-hmm. we also have a team who've worked closely with the teams controlling Japanese encephalitis in Asia through vaccination. Because the important thing
about
JE, there's a vaccine.
Yeah.
And again, it was slightly nuts. You know, when I got into this field years ago, there are vaccines available. But the various committees that were sort of discussing vaccine work in Geneva mm-hmm. Seemed to spend time talking about developing new vaccines, which is okay. But I was kind of saying, well, what about the vaccines that we know work? Why are we not talking about getting these used more widely? And people in Seattle got interested in this, particularly someone called Julie Jacobson, who subsequently the Gates Foundation, mm-hmm. they gave a grant initially of about $14 million. To a team, which included Liverpool, included the governments in Asia, included other academic partners, included the WHO and PATH in Seattle, who are a catalyst for a lot of these things. And essentially, we've worked on trying to understand why aren't the vaccines being used, and the issues were there wasn't very good surveillance for Japanese encephalitis, so we developed some surveillance guidelines, and they're now being used in pretty well every country in Asia. And, you know, it's not rocket science. If someone comes with a fever and fitting and coma, do the test for JE. Right. The other really interesting problem was that JE probably kills 10 or 20% of kids that get infected. JE is Japanese encephalitis. But the big problem really is all the children who are left with brain damage with neurological sequelae, because somebody's going to have to look after them for the rest of their life. Yeah. So in terms of the health economics, they are the problem. But there was no simple way of measuring their outcomes. Mm-hmm. And so we set it up, we developed a score called the Liverpool Outcome Score, just a very simple way of measuring outcomes. And then once governments know we have this many children with the disease, this is how we measure the outcome, they can then put a cost on it, a health economic cost on it. And then they can do the math to say, is it worth vaccinating? You know, right, this is how much. Right. And of course it was worth vaccinating. Yeah. So basically, in the last 5 years, I think 100 million children have been vaccinated. Mm-hmm. In fact, I think it's more. 100 million was by the end of 2010.
This is an injected vaccine,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah. It's a live attenuated vaccine made by the Chinese. But there are also, there are killed vaccines available. Mm-hmm. So through that work, we've really made some steps towards getting JE under control.
Right. So you mentioned a blood-brain barrier model. Is that to understand how viruses get into the CNS?
Absolutely, yeah. So in terms of CNS virology, there's always the same questions that come up. I think there's only really two questions, actually. One is, how's it got in there?
Right.
And then two is, how much of the damage is due to the virus and how much is due to the host response?
Right.
And if you could answer all those questions, you then know what kind of treatments to develop and how. So the model, yeah, the model has an endothelium, a vascular endothelium. The endothelium is the lining of the blood vessel.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also has the astrocytes, which are the brain cells. They're sort of supporting skeletal cells that are wrapped tightly around the blood vessels.
Mm-hmm.
And they also have an immune function. So together, these form a they form tight junctions. They form this very tight blood-brain barrier.
Mm-hmm.
So in most of your body, viruses and poisons can get across blood vessels relatively easily. In the brain, it's a lot tighter.
That's by design, I presume.
I think so. Yeah, because the brain's the most important and interesting bit of the body.
Also, probably the brain doesn't want to mount a vigorous immune response, right?
Exactly.
Is that a reasonable...
Exactly. So people used to call it immune privilege.
Yeah.
They thought no immune cells got in there. Now people talk about immune... what's the word? Different. I think they used to call it immune naive. Now you'll have to cut this bit.
No, it's okay. We're human.
We're human.
We're trying to remember immunoprivileged was one...
Anyway, the point is...
There's another word I can't remember.
The point is, they used to think no immune cells get in. Now, it's just different.
They
get in, but not so many. And the reason is, there are two reasons. One is your neurons. You only get one set of them.
Right.
So you don't want the immune cells killing them off, damaging them, because you can't remake them. And then also, you're in this tight space called the cranium or the skull. So if you get a nasty infection on your arm, it swells up.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. If you get it in your head and it swells up, you're in trouble.
That's encephalitis, right?
That's encephalitis. And So some of our work is looking at non-specific ways of controlling the swelling. What drugs can we use? We use corticosteroids.
Mm-hmm.
There's not really been any trials for most of the important forms of encephalitis. And we've just got funding from the UK government to do a study of steroids in herpes simplex virus encephalitis. That will answer that. But steroids are pretty crude.
Would you use that
drugs.
For West Nile encephalitis?
You could do, but you wouldn't know whether it worked. People will use it. If they think there's very tight swelling,
They'll
use it. Although they'll be worried because there's no antivirus drug being used.
Yeah.
So at least for herpes, you're giving an antivirus drug, you're giving acyclovir, and then you think, well, maybe we can give an immunosuppressant. But the worry is that as well as controlling the swelling, you're dampening down the immune system, and then maybe the virus... replicates in an uncontrolled manner. So it's a really difficult juggling act, and that's why we're doing this study to try and look at it.
So how do viruses get through this endothelium and astrocyte layers then?
There's thought to be three or four ways. So one idea is that they just go into the endothelium and they replicate, like they'll replicate
right.
in other cells and
right.
they get passed on. There's also something called... again, this is one's called trans and one's called cis. You hopefully can help me. One of them, the virus gets taken up by an endocytotic vesicle,
right.
carried across,
transcytosis,
and spat out. That's
right.
transcytosis.
Yeah, yeah.
And then cis, I can't remember what cis is. So the other postulated route is in the gaps between cells.
So it's actually cells can get through that, diepidesis.
Yeah, that's,
right?
And that's the other way, the Trojan horse type approach.
Yeah. Right.
So there's a whole range of
So for EV71, do you know which of these? I presume you're looking at it, right?
We are looking at it. We've got someone working the model at the moment.
You don't have to tell me. You can just say you're looking at it.
Yeah,
I'll
pretend I'm looking. We're looking at it. We have something really exciting we're going to tell you.
Because as far as I know, we really don't know for any virus which of these is right. Because it's hard to do the experiments.
The best data we have is on JE, where we have actually shown, and this is really interesting. So. Because there was confusion in the literature. Sometimes people see virus in the endothelium, the cells lining the blood vessels, And you know, the question was, is it replicating there or not? And work that we've done recently shows, seems to show, what happens is the virus gets into the endothelium, but it doesn't really replicate because you have an innate response. And that innate response in stopping the virus from replicating also disrupts the what we call the tight junctions between the cells.
Right.
And
right.
they then become loose, and then the virus may get across.
Sure. So perfectly reasonable.
Yeah.
I mean, that happens in mucosal epithelia with viruses. Coxsackie viruses bind a receptor. You get signaling, the junctions loosen up.
Right.
And the virus goes in there and actually binds the productive receptor.
Right.
So that would make sense in endothelial cells as well.
Yeah.
There's a very cool paper we did on one of my other podcasts recently. Cryptococcus, another one that gets in the brain, right? I don't know if you deal with that at all. Cryptococcus neoformans,
coccidioidomycosis. Yeah.
So they have a blood-brain barrier model, mm-hmm. endothelial and polarized. They can add cryptococci to the top and it gets through.
Mm-hmm.
And they can easily just count colony-forming units, right? So they found a single metalloprotease that's essential for that. If you knock it out, it doesn't get through.
Right.
If you take that gene and put it into Saccharomyces, which is normally not invasive, it will cross.
Right.
It's brilliant. One gene.
Right, fantastic.
Which is what we all hope for, but never happens, right?
Where was that published then?
It was published in the last month or two in MBio.
Okay.
And we did it on TWiV, which is one of my sister or brother or... sibling podcasts, I should say. Fascinating, because I was interested for years in how polio would get in, and we really didn't get any answers, but it's one of the many that you mentioned above.
Yeah, yeah.
I think it's an interesting question. Do you think most viruses get in the brain?
I think probably most do.
And most we don't know are there, right?
Yeah, so for example, if you take herpes simplex virus, we know that if you look at 100 people who've died from a road traffic accident,
you can find herpes in the brain.
Yeah, you can find herpes in the brain in them.
What else can you find?
Probably everything.
Because, I mean, you know, we all have lots of these little DNA viruses in our blood, BK, polyomaviruses.
Yeah, yeah.
You must be finding
I mean, we've done... So one of the other projects we've recently published from Africa, actually, again, this is Mac Malewa's work. So he was looking at these kids with cerebral malaria and, again, trying to understand what viruses might be contributing. So it wasn't just rabies, but he found a whole range of other viruses actually in the central nervous system. You know, much more than you'd expect. I think a third of the patients with cerebral malaria had evidence of virus infection. It raises whole issues around interactions between microbes and dual infections, and it may well be that there are dual infections happening.
I know years ago we knew that mumps
gets
in, half of the kids' brains who are infected.
Exactly.
And they're fine.
Yeah, that's right. I was thinking of that. So if you do a lumbar puncture, you find mumps virus in there, don't you? And if you do EEGs, brainwave tests, you find a lot of them have a slightly abnormal EEG, electroencephalogram.
Electroencephalogram.
You got me.
Did you develop a little accent when you were in Texas?
Oh, terrible accent.
Oh, not terrible. Texans don't think it's terrible.
No, I mean a terrible accent because it was a hybrid between my sort of northern UK accent and Texan. But you have to, basically, if you don't talk in Texan, they don't understand you. So, you know, we would walk into a McDonald's, let's say, with the kids and say, you know, could I have a Big Mac, please? And they, you are? I'm not getting you there. So one, the language is wrong, and two, the accent's wrong, because they don't use the word please. I need a Big Mac, then they get you. Or give me a Big Mac, easy on the fries.
You know, a lot of people go to the UK from countries that you would never hear a British, and they develop British accents.
Yeah.
And then the combination, I met a guy, I can't remember where he's from, but he had a slight... I think he was from China. Yes,
right.
This guy from China. And he had been working in the UK, and he had a British accent. And my gosh, I said, you know, you've developed a bit. He said, really?
Really? Was it Chinese British or just pure sort of English accent?
Just
was
English
it?
Accent.
Really?
But he had an accent because he's speaking English. Yeah. He's Chinese native, and then he's got a British accent on top of it. It's really...
But you do. People do it all the time. Kids do it especially. So our kids...
Yes, your kids were young in Texas.
Amazing Texas accents. And then within...
They must have loved it, right?
They loved it. We all had a great time. I mean, I tease about Texas, but then I've discovered that's okay because all Americans tease about Texas.
Yeah, we make fun of them too.
Yeah, but it's a great state. The warmth of the people, the friendliness of the people is really great, very welcoming. And we had a great time then. The kids loved it. And then they developed these great accents. They did the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States. It was amazing. And then when we got back to Liverpool, they developed Scouse accents, which is a kind of, you talk like this, it don't really pass out. And they got those Scouse accents back within 2 weeks of being back in Liverpool.
So the other thing I wanted to ask you, when the virus gets in the brain, is the damage virus-induced or immunological, as you said? Are you working on that as well?
We are, yeah.
And what kind of system do you use to do that?
Two systems. One system we find quite helpful is called the human being. We find it's a very good model of the human being. And in fact, so quite a lot of our studies are on humans. So we look at host response genes, both in the, well, we look at protein in the spinal fluid. We look at gene expression in the blood. Mike Griffiths, a senior clinical lecturer who I mentioned earlier, is leading on this work, and he's got some very nice microarray tools that can distinguish not just whether you're going to have a good or bad outcome, but also distinguish between pathogens. So, you know, I think this is going to be a really useful approach for the future. So that's the kind of studying the human. And then in the lab, we're looking at how neuronal cells respond to virus. So again, work that Gossia and Mike have been doing, where we put herpes simplex virus onto astrocytes and find that, interestingly, that some of the earliest damage seems to be in the mitochondrial pathways, which isn't what we'd expect. It's not what I'd have expected. And it seems that if we have drugs that can control this or support it, simple drugs like tetracyclines, which are in everyday use for other conditions, seem to inhibit this effect. This is a really neat paper, actually, that the guys have just submitted. So anyone out there who's about to review it, read it carefully, please. I mean, those are the model systems we're using. We have done mouse work in the past.
Yeah,
we have to. I mean, I'm being very frank, using the M word, because I'm tired. Whereas, unfortunately, in the UK, we usually have to talk in euphemisms.
Rodent?
Models.
Models.
Vivo models, which I find a bit tiresome. And again, so when I started out in these kind of areas 15, 20 years ago, we were encouraged by the authorities, you know, to be all secret hush-hush, which I think is wrong. I mean, okay, there were some lunatics out there who were trying to kill people who worked in these areas.
Right.
You have this a bit in the US.
Right, of course, sure.
But the problem is, if you're frightened by those lunatics, then it means there's a void. Nobody sensible is talking. So the only people who are talking is the lunatics. So again, I think we have a responsibility, actually, to talk openly about the work.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, you know, because the majority of people won't accept these lunatics. In fact, I wrote a piece saying, you know, why are we not calling them terrorists? It was after 9/11 and all that. You know, we have these terrorists in terms of their other agendas.
Right.
And I wrote a piece saying, why aren't we calling these animal rights terrorists? It's terrorism. They're trying to use terror to change things rather than using the democratic route.
Sure, yeah.
So anyway, Gordon Brown was the prime minister at the time. I'd like to think he read my letter in the Times, but he certainly didn't phone me to discuss it. But anyway, there was a sea change. I mean, as often, a lot of people have the same thoughts at the same time. And they basically said, we're going to go for these people. And they did. And thank God they did, because, you know, the environment's changed now.
Yeah, we're pretty open here about that in the U.S.
Yeah.
You know, but there have been problems. There's a cadre of people who don't like certain kinds of work. But I think, again, we're not explaining things very well.
I have. I mean, I've called them lunatics, which is a bit disrespectful and may well result in a bomb under my car in the morning. I don't think a lunatic. Most people who are in the animal rights lobby, they feel passionately, which I understand completely. I've been involved in debates with people. And, you know, I have total respect for somebody who says they would rather that there are no animal experiments. If that's their view, that's fine. As long as they're prepared to accept that, you know, they have their view, but in a democracy we go with the majority view.
Yes.
But I don't have any respect for those if they want to terrorize others into not following the law.
Right.
But also the people I have a bit of a problem with are those who have this view which they hold passionately, which I don't have a problem with. But then they get into fuzzy waters about the rationale. So I think if you're going to not, you don't want any animal experiments, that's fine. But then when you go to hospital, when you accept drug treatments, please make inquiries about what the role was of animal experimentation in the drug you're about to take to save your life. Because for pretty well every drug, there was some stage where it was really important that animal experiments were done.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, you know, hold the view, but then don't try and pretend that you're not going to benefit from the animal work which was done.
No, I mean, all the Ebola work we've talked about is
exactly,
done in animals
exactly.
so far.
And nobody likes doing these experiments. I've done them. Nobody gets pleasure out of making an animal sick. But, you know, there's quite a lot we do in life that we don't particularly want to do, but we do it because we think there's a benefit.
Yeah. Do you think there's any role for polymorphisms in people who get encephalitis?
Susceptibilities,
yeah.
Mean? Yeah, there is a bit of evidence for that, particularly around herpes simplex virus.
Yes.
So there's a guy called Casanova. You met
here at the Rockefeller, yeah.
Is he next door? Okay.
Well, not next door, yeah. But here in New York. I point all the time, and people look. I say, no, I just...
Because you've got Ian Lipkin next door as well, haven't
He's that way.
Yeah, I didn't... sorry, I didn't get time to come and say hello, Ian. Maybe next time. But, yeah, there is some evidence that...
I know for herpes is really good evidence.
Yeah, so if you're one of those two children who had this polymorphism, that's a very important polymorphism for you.
But what about JEV?
JE, probably. I mean, for related viruses like dengue, there's some evidence of HLA susceptibilities. So it's extremely likely there are.
You don't work on that, though?
We've done a little bit, or tried to.
But you're in the perfect position to do it.
We are. We're actually, at the moment, we're wanting to do it around Enterovirus 71.
Okay.
Because for JE, you know, in terms of one's research portfolio, you kind of have to balance. Certainly we do, I do as a medic, what's driving what you do? How much is it because this is interesting?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
But also how much is it because you think you might be able to make a difference?
Sure.
And so for JE, I think the biggest difference we've made is supporting the missing pieces of the jigsaw that were needed to get vaccination rolled out. For Enterovirus 71, we don't have any vaccine, we don't have any treatment. We are doing work looking at, it's the same old questions, it's the same questions that we always ask.
Mm-hmm.
But for Enterovirus 71, it's really important because we potentially could develop treatments to stop people developing this really severe disease. So the other thing we have for EV71 is a cardiomyocyte model. Very interesting as well as encephalitis, their hearts stop working.
Mm-hmm.
And we're trying to work out why that is.
Yeah.
So we're putting in a proposal at the moment to do a lot of work on EV71, including looking for genetic polymorphisms.
Mm-hmm. So do you have any interest in polio at all?
I do.
You don't see any patients?
Don't see. We saw a little bit in Vietnam, I think, just as it was becoming under control. But as you know, polio, unfortunately, you know, the story at the moment is just a story again of our inability to use the resources, you know, use the tools we have to completely control a disease.
Yeah.
And again, sadly, you know, it relates to, I don't know, is it anthropology? Is it, I don't know what the terms are. It's way outside our field.
But it's outside of science, right?
Well, not outside of science. It's just a different type of science.
Maybe,
you know, how do you convince people living in remote hill tribes in wherever it is in the middle of Asia that actually these people bring along these vials are trying to do some good? They're not trying to sterilize everyone.
Yeah.
This isn't some political thing. Please don't shoot them. They're just trying to help.
Yeah. We have good vaccines. We could eradicate it with them.
Yeah. You know, we've got very close.
Yeah.
But the wars are getting in the way, essentially.
What's your thought? Can we get there or is it impossible?
Can we get there or is it impossible? I think we can get there. Yeah, I think we can. But I think it's more, there's more to it than just turning up in a truck with some vaccine.
So
we have to operate. We've got to totally, you know, the guys who are involved in these wars and who see life very differently to the way we do, we have to just have a totally different approach to get to them and work through them so that they will support vaccination in their areas.
It's an interesting development going on now. I don't know if you followed this, but... as you may know, the WHO has suggested we start switching to inactivated polio vaccine.
Yeah.
The Salk injected.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Because the Sabin vaccine causes polio.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so even if you one day eradicate, as long as you continue to immunize with Sabin, you're going to have paralysis, which is why we stopped using Sabin.
In the States.
In Israel, they've used Salk vaccine for a while now.
Yeah.
and viruses circulating there.
Right.
Wild polio, there's no paralysis, but right. they can find it in sewage all over the country.
Right.
Because when you get Salk, your intestines are not immune.
Right, so you're still passing the virus on, but just not getting sick. That's really interesting. I didn't know that.
And I was just at a meeting this summer, and a woman from Israel was giving a poster on this. It's fascinating. So the implication is, if the world switched to Salk before we got rid of circulating wild virus, we would never get rid of it.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
Now, I asked someone from the CDC, do we have circulating wild virus in the U.S.?
The States,
and he
yeah.
said, Vincent, we don't look, because if we find it, we don't know what to say.
Yeah.
So I suspect it is. Using Salk or Sabin in the UK, do you know?
Still, I think live vaccine.
So this is a bit of a conundrum, because as long as you're using Sabin vaccine, you're circulating.
Get a small number of
you have paralysis, and those viruses actually circulate as well. In the, so
and especially the immunosuppressed are at risk, aren't they? People are on immune drugs.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So this is a conundrum that WHO is downplaying. They don't know how to deal with it, I think, but I think it's kind of a problem.
It's one of these problems that becomes an interesting sort of intellectual problem as a result of success in an area, doesn't
That's
it?
Right.
You know, decades
That's right.
ago, just give the vaccine, you know, let's just get it out there. I suppose you reach a point where, I mean, if we were using oral polio vaccine everywhere, what's the incidence of clinical, you know, polio disease caused by the vaccine-associated paralytic polio? Is it 1 in 1 million or less?
Well, in the U.S., when we used it, it was 1 in 1.5 million doses.
Right.
I was told, I was in Australia this summer, that they have never had a case of a vaccine-associated polio.
Right.
And India has been using it, and as you know, they eradicated wild polio.
Yeah.
There's no report of, so I think...
Of VAPP. Yeah, I think...
It's dependent on the population for some reason.
But I think also you have to say, don't you, I mean, most good vaccines, the risk of a serious adverse event is about 1 in 1 million, as I understand it.
Mm-hmm.
You're always going to get that. You know, for most vaccines, you just have to accept it. I think. So, for example, for the killed JE vaccines that people used to get, you know, it had a bad period when it was causing some adverse events, mostly just, you know, skin rashes or whatever, nothing too serious. But it did cause encephalitis in about 1 in 1 million. But you have to ask yourself, what is the acceptable, you know, what are you going to accept? We've had all this measles, you know, debacle over the last 10 years or
right,
so, haven't we?
Right.
You know, I don't think any of that, are there vaccines? I mean, which vaccine? Yellow fever we used to think was perfectly safe, and it's not. You know, why would you ever be able to create anything that is 100% guaranteed safe? There's no absolutes, are there? It's about relative risk.
Nothing in the world is safe. Driving isn't safe,
so
flying.
You're not going to have a vaccine. You're not going to have any vaccine that is 100% safe. So you have to say, what's the acceptable risk? And maybe 1 in 1 million is it. And then if that's the case, then in America, you need to get back to the oral polio vaccine and just accept that, unfortunately, for the many, many lives that you save, 1 in 1 million kids is going to be unlucky. And because kids, from what you've just described, using killed vaccine is asking for trouble.
Well, but the problem is with the Sabin vaccine, they end up in the sewer also, and they circulate and can last for years as well. So,
yeah, but which strain would you rather have in the sewer? The vaccine strain or the live deadly virus?
They're essentially the same once they come out of a person.
Right.
So the Sabin strains come out of the gut and they're reverted, and within a year of circulating in the population, they look exactly like wild type virus in terms of their transmissibility and neurovirulence. So, it's a conundrum, because I think neither vaccine at this point is the one we should probably have. An inactivated vaccine that gives you good gut immunity. And, you know, the Gates is really interested in helping people find such a vaccine.
Right.
But we don't have it at the moment. So it's a really interesting problem, because we're almost there, but the vaccines now are kind of limiting.
Causing some of the problems, yeah. But I don't know, I think you've also got to decide. I mean, I'm sure if you're a polio vaccine person, then, you know, this is interesting and obviously you want to pursue it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there are lots of questions.
As a society, you have to decide.
You have to decide
where
you're
going
to. You go to the inactivated vaccine. Do you do an experiment and see if maybe, in over long term, the replication fizzles out because there aren't enough susceptible. Who knows? It's a really interesting question.
Yeah.
I think it's fascinating, and eradication isn't straightforward. That's for sure. But it does take money. Yeah. And that's the thing. If Gates or whoever is involved with funding gets bored, then you're in trouble.
But right? It may be that, you know, maybe we have to accept that actually smallpox was an oddity in terms of being something that we could completely eradicate. And, you know, Rinderpest, is it Rinderpest?
It is, right.
But
right.
Maybe we actually have to accept that for other diseases, maybe even for polio,
right?
It's going to be about, we may get down to zero cases, but we're still always going to have to vaccinate.
Perhaps for a while, yeah. It could be that we vaccinate for 10, 20 years and then we monitor and see if the virus is gone.
But from what you've described, if you're using a killed virus,
it's a problem, yeah.
Then you're going to have live virus circulating. And if you're using a live attenuated virus, you're going to have virus in the sewage. So by definition, we're not going to, from what you've just described, we're never going to be able to actually eradicate the virus, only the disease.
Based on the Israel experience, now it could be that in different places that you get a different result, so I don't know, but I'm a little concerned.
Yeah,
I just thought I would throw that out and see what you thought about that. Well, this has been fascinating. Great conversation. Is there anything I missed?
I don't think so. I better check my... I had a little list. I think we've covered everything, more than. I'm sure there's people in the group. I mean, I didn't try and mention all the PhD students.
Oh, that's all right.
I call them my middle graders.
That's fine. I'm sure they're happy to see you on
TWiV. Will you put some links up to things if I give
absolutely.
The links?
Absolutely. You can send me things. I usually go through and I'll put your papers in. But do send me things that you'd like to get in,
sure. That'd be great. Thank you.
And we'll get that up. And this episode, just like all the others, will be at twiv.tv and also on iTunes. And if you have questions for Tom, just email them.
Do we deal with them online then?
They send them to us, twiv@twiv.tv.
Ah, I knew we'd forgotten something really important.
And I'll forward them, yeah.
My Twitter hashtag.
Yeah,
my Twitter handle is @runningmadprof.
Runningmadprof.
@runningmadprof, all one word. How many followers do you have on TWiV?
On Twitter?
No, on TWiV. How many people?
Oh, we have somewhere between 10 and 20,000 listeners.
Right, guys. Okay, you've enjoyed the podcast. This is your time to do me a favor. Because I've got this bet on with my brother about who is going to have the most followers on Twitter by the end of the year.
How many do you have right now?
Oh, it's pathetic. It's a few hundred.
Oh, no.
Come on, TWiV guys.
Listeners, give the mad...
Running Mad Prof.
At Running Mad Prof. Give him a follow. And
give me a following.
If you're not following me, you should follow me too.
Yeah. You've got millions.
I'm Prof. VRR.
Yeah, you've got loads of followers.
I've got almost 7,000. We're approaching 7,000. I've been doing this for a long time, though.
Yeah.
I've been working at it. One or two a day, you know, they accrue.
It happens slowly, doesn't it? It's a drip, drip.
Yep. But you have to be very patient. You know, nothing came.
I'm not patient. I'm a running mad person. Listen, guys, I want 10,000 by the end of the week. Get onto it.
Okay, you hear them.
And what I'll do on the Twit is I'll tweet some of the links, like to the Running Mad Professor video.
That would be great. We'll
the biggest brain, the world's biggest brain.
The world's biggest brain is fabulous. I love that idea. I have to do a world's biggest virus. This would be wonderful. As I said, Central Park. You guys, the TWiV Army, do you want to do this? If you're here in New York City, let's organize it.
That would be great. You'll have to deal with the Guinness World Record people who are ferocious.
They are?
Oh, yeah. It's not an easy... Like I told you, my running... You know, I was terrified that if I dropped my stethoscope as I ran the London Marathon, I wasn't going to get my record.
You weren't going to get the record.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
Well, you got it.
Mm.
All right. Well, thanks so much for joining. Tom Solomon, University of Liverpool. I appreciate your coming by. Hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you. It's been great fun.
Thank you. I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you can find me at my blog, which is virology.ws. I'm Prof. VRR on Twitter. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral.